Good morning, folks. My name is Kripal Amana, and welcome to the first edition of the Gourmet Biker Show, a show where we will ride across the country on my motorcycle, exploring some great food. Karnataka is blessed with great coffee. So there's great coffee in Coorg, there's Chikmagalur, and there's Sakleshpur. Whilst most people know Coorg and Chikmagalur, which of course is the birthplace of coffee in India, not much is known about Sakleshpur. So Sakleshpur in that way is a little off the beaten track. So today we're going to ride out to an estate in Sakleshpur, more specifically in the Manjarabad region. We're going to ride out there, explore great coffee of course, and also hopefully some great food. So let's get on the road and ride to Sakleshpur. And so I was off to a smooth start on an NH75 that leads on to Mangalore via Hassan. I have done this route a few times and it's a great one for motorcycling, notwithstanding the odd traffic congestions due to roadblocks and diversions. Before long, I had arrived at my regular biker breakfast hall for a light South Indian breakfast, or tiffin as the locals like to call it.
So we are at Mayura at Belur Cross. If you are on the road towards Hassan, towards Sakleshpur, this is a good place to stop and get a nice light breakfast.
After this tasty breakfast, I was back on the smooth roads. It's incredible how our highway network has improved over the last few years. Now is definitely a good time to get out on the roads. But some things haven't changed. Folks on two-wheelers coming at you the wrong way, cattle on the road. But I wasn't complaining. I was enjoying the ride, and as I got closer to Sakleshpur, I could see the landscape changing. The broad highways gave way to winding roads, small towns, and the air was definitely getting crisper and fresher. In less than 5 hours since we left Bangalore, we had arrived in Sakleshpur.
So we've arrived at our destination, Harley Estate, about 3,100 feet above sea level, in Sakleshpur, in the Manjarabad region of Sakleshpur to be precise. This estate was founded in 1860 by an Englishman named Mr. Harley. I'm sure if we dig deeper, we may perhaps find a connection between him and the other Harley, that is Mr. William Harley, son of an English immigrant who went on to found Harley Davidson Motorcycles in Milwaukee in 1903. Anyway, that's my imagination, but let's ride in and meet the fifth generation family that owns this coffee estate today, the family of Mr. D.M. Purnesh. So I am with Chandani and Tapaswini, the fifth generation of the family that owns Harley Estate. So tell us a bit about Harley Estate.
So Harley Estate was started in the 1860s. Our family has bought it about 15 years ago.
Okay.
We have 550 acres here. We have a quaint little eco holiday home in the middle of all of that. So hopefully we'll like take you through all of it now. And
we're going to explore a lot more of Harley Estate in the next couple of days. But right now I hear Chandani's got for us some Malnad speciality, some Malnad delicacies. So we're going to head out there for lunch, and there's going to be a bit of a ride there, so there's no such thing as a free lunch, so I'm going to ride more. So you're going to do a bit of a ride, get to the waterfalls and enjoy a great Malnad lunch.
Thank you.
So we're in this gazebo, in this beautiful setting by the waterfall here. And of course, I'm with Chandini and I've got all this food here. So that's quite a feast. And this is what you call Malnad cuisine.
Yes.
Right? And what's the cuisine like?
So we are basically rice eaters and meat eaters. And most of the vegetables and fruit that we have is seasonal and foraged from around the area. So even the kadus are made from rice. We tend to use a lot of coconut and spices in our food.
Malenadu basically refers to land of the mountains.
Right.
Right? So is there any significance, is there any reference with regards to the food? I mean, do you have a lot of local produce that gets...
Yes, this is something that we grow here in Asia.
Okay.
This is suvarnagedde or elephant yam.
Okay.
This is again, it's a wild mango that grows in this region.
Mm-hmm.
So we've actually made a savory dish out of the mango.
Okay.
Which goes well with the rice. This again is red rice that's grown organically in the area, unpolished.
Okay.
So we use the same rice as well to make the kadbus and the rotis and all of that.
So the focus here is on consuming what is grown in and around the area. And I also see this pork here, which I guess is a staple again. It's as important as the rice.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. And so what do we have here?
We have a pepper fry of pork here. This is again a very typical Malnad style of preparing it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Enough talking, I'm going to get straight into the food. So what should I begin with?
Start with the kadbus.
And this is a different sort of a kadbu.
We've added a little bit of masala to it with the leaves and all of that.
And that goes with
well
the...
with the chicken curry.
So this is like a local home style chicken curry. I'm good with that.
And some pork on the side.
So I'm going to go for the pork right away. Sorry, can't resist. Beautiful. I love the way the fat's actually rendered down.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost, it's melt in your mouth. Beautiful.
So you have to have some of this all over your gravy and your kadbu.
And I also noticed, I mean, you've got a different sort of a paisa.
Yes.
Or a kheer.
People would recognize it as a kheer.
As a kheer, that's right. And so what's special about this here?
This is a gasgase paisa.
Mm-hmm.
This is very popular in this area. You know, most people are farmers. They like to come home, like have a little bit of this and pass out for the evening.
So that's poppy seeds.
Yes, that's poppy seeds.
Right. So this is what we're going to do at the end of the meal. So you were saying meat's an integral part of the food.
Yeah,
here.
Meat is an integral part of food here and of hosting.
Okay.
So when you're invited to someone's home,
mm-hmm.
it's expected by them and by the person who's coming that there is going to be a good non-vegetarian feast on the table. There will be fish, chicken, mutton, pork for sure. Like I was saying, other delicacies. One is toddies, something palm toddy. That's something that we have a lot of.
Yeah. So if you wait another month, actually, we'll get some amazing soft-shell crabs.
Soft-shell crabs here?
Yeah, on the paddy fields.
Okay.
You get these little fish that are cooked whole because they're just tiny. They're called mandal meenu.
Okay.
We get amazing mushrooms, which is there for a very short time.
Again, next month.
So
we're going to come back next month.
Yeah, you should for sure.
You'll have a whole other menu on the table.
Really? You know, for me, the beautiful thing about this meal is, of course, there's all these dishes, but it's like somebody's prepared it for you at home.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's the most beautiful part of this meal out here, whether it's the kadbu, the chicken curry, or the pork, or the
suvarnagedde.
I mean, the vegetable. I think everything is made with so much love, and I think that shows in the food.
Correct. And that's what we want to give people. We want to give them that home experience, that experience of being a farmer, living here, eating our kind of food that's homemade, home prepped, with a lot of love, like you said. So.
After that lovely lunch and conversation with the sisters, I wandered around the property a bit. Lush greenery as far as the eyes could see, gurgling waterfalls, placid lakes. This was paradise. A short nap later, it was time for dinner. So it's been a great day, a fabulous ride getting to Harley Estate, Sakleshpur,
followed by a really special Malnad lunch. And what better way to wind down the day than sit in front of this very cozy bonfire right in front of my cottage here at Golden Wood, sipping on a glass of wine and enjoying some barbecue fare. I was up early the next morning, just in time to catch a glorious sunrise over Harley Estate. The setting was surreal, birds chirping, the fresh air. It's a feeling that's completely rejuvenating, especially for a city dweller like me. I set out for my rendezvous with Chandani to walk around the estate and hopefully gain some insight into life on a plantation.
Good morning. Rest well?
Very well. I mean, look at this beautiful scene and the beautiful air. That's the one thing that immediately hits you when you come into an environment like this. That's right. This is about 500 acres.
Yes, we are about 550 acres here. And predominantly coffee. We also have some side crops, pepper, cocoa, cardamom.
All right.
Yeah. Golden Wood, we started with trying to create an experience for our guests along with a story. So we want our guests to actually see what it's like to be living on a plantation like this.
So a big part of Golden Wood is also the eco aspect.
All right. So we're trying to be as sustainable as possible. We generate our own electricity. We use solar and hydropower through the property. We also have like zero plastic waste that are coming out of there. The rest of the organic waste we use, we actually make compost on the estate and reuse it on the plants.
So it's completely recycled.
Yes. We have different cottages. Each cottage is styled at a different time in history. So we are going to walk up to one now, which is actually the oldest one, which is almost 100 plus year old. It's a mud house.
Okay, so you've preserved the architecture.
Yes, we've preserved the architecture. We've preserved all the woodwork and everything in it. So you actually go back in time, disconnect from everything else.
Back to the good old days.
Yes.
So you've really preserved this as a way of life.
Yes, as much as possible we've tried to retain things as they are in their natural beauty, right from the landscaping, the spaces around us. So there are like rose bushes here that are over 50 years old. The red oxide inside is original, that was done 100 years ago. You know, so the landscaping, even when you just sit outside, like you're looking at the paddy fields on one side, you're looking at the coffee estate on one side, you have the stream flowing between them. So we haven't tried to change anything, we haven't tried to modify it or make it more nicer for people to actually come and maybe sit there. We wanted to keep it as natural as possible.
Wow, this is quite something. It's very different when you're looking at the coffee estate
from the outside.
And when you're in here. So when it comes to coffee, I mean, there are two types of coffee.
Yeah, two types of coffee that we sell commercially.
All right.
One is the Robusta and the other is the Arabica. So we have both on this estate, predominantly Robusta. We have about 30% of our plantation is Arabica.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what goes into deciding whether, you know, you plant Robusta or you plant Arabica?
So the weather conditions, the land that you have, all of this determines what kind of plants will grow better in that area. So April is when we have the blossoms.
Okay.
And your entire estate is white, perfumed. You can, you know, it's just 3 days of like absolute beautiful, you know, flowers right through the estate.
It must be surreal at that point. There were hundreds of acres and you just see a white.
And anywhere your eyes can see, you just see white.
Wow.
And, yeah. Post that is when, you know, these berries start coming in.
All right.
These are what grow to become bigger berries. When they're ripe, they're a dark red.
Okay.
That's when we harvest them. So the harvest season is typically between November to February or March.
Yeah. And so you harvest them and then they go through a process before.
Yes. So these are the pepper flowers that are just coming out.
So these will...
Yeah, these will what will become the cons and then...
Alright.
So other than pepper, we also grow cardamom, cocoa.
Okay.
And areca in this estate.
People are a very integral part of...
Yes.
You know, all
yes.
this obviously doesn't happen just by itself. Yeah. Sure, nature does play a hand, but it's the people. And the one thing, I mean, you've got armies of people. I mean, that's what I guess it takes.
Mm-hmm.
To look after something like this. And the other aspect that I noticed when I looked at all the houses, you've got the estate manager's bungalow, you've got the workers, you know, quarters and all of that. So it's almost like a township.
We have almost about 150 to 200 people who are permanent labor here. And so we provide housing for all of them. We have a school that's running for their children, you know, so we want to make sure they're not wasting time here. They're actually learning something in their free time. We provide nutrition drives, healthcare, utilities.
We had covered nearly a small area of the humongous 550-acre estate, but all that walking had left me hungry. And that's when our thoughtful host announced that she had organized a plantation breakfast with a bit of a twist.
So today for breakfast we have akki rotis, that is rotis made out of rice.
So that's a staple,
yes,
rice.
Yes, that's a staple here.
Okay.
We're having that with fresh homemade butter.
Okay.
So this is something that we call chigli chutney.
Okay.
It's made out of ants.
Mm-hmm.
So we usually grab the nest and wash it out and make the chutney out of the ants that are remaining in it. It's actually very sour.
Is it?
Very
okay.
high in vitamin C.
All right.
Yeah.
Ants and for breakfast, not quite the twist I had expected. And as Chandani gleefully extolled the virtues of these fiery things, I tried hard to appear unmoved. Thankfully, there were other dishes on the menu that didn't crawl or sting.
This is fish curry.
Mm-hmm.
And we have something called kesa.
Okay.
So that's our, again, a local delicacy, which is basically colocasia leaves that are knotted up and then made into palya form of dish. This is again another seasonal delicacy, which is halsin hittu.
Okay.
Which is made out of jackfruit.
Okay.
It's like a cake that's made out of jackfruit.
In fact, this takes me back, this jackfruit preparation. In fact, it's a very, I think it's also a very South Canara thing.
It is, yeah.
I mean, I remember, I think when I was a kid growing up, my mom would cook this.
So we also have some fruit here that are just growing around us.
Wonderful.
Which we've cut. There's some local honey to go with any of them if you'd like.
All right.
Yeah.
So I'm going to try a bit of the chigli first. Bit of this. Is this enough?
You can have a lot more than that.
A lot more?
Yeah.
Okay. With some ghee?
Yes.
With some akki roti. Okay. So, and some butter on the akki roti.
On the akki roti.
So I got to mix up the ghee and the... So if you didn't tell me that we were eating ants, I wouldn't know.
Yeah, you wouldn't know.
Like you said, it's sour, but it's also very grainy.
It is. So you can, there are different styles of preparing it.
Okay.
So some people actually make it even finer and add it with like coconut to make it more like a coconut based chutney as well. Again, that goes with ghee.
Again, more ghee.
Yeah.
Butter.
Yes.
I guess that's where those long walks, I think, come in handy, right?
We need energies to go through
the estate. Energies to go through the estate. This takes me right back.
Yeah.
So good.
Breakfast was delicious and I quite liked the mackerel curry with akki roti too. After yet another big meal, I could have easily plonked myself in a cozy corner of this haven for a quick nap. However, Tapaswini had plans for me and I was invited to a coffee tasting at her coffee lab.
Hi Kripal, how are you doing?
Doing fine.
Doing good.
Doing fine. We had a great day today.
Yeah, we went and visited the estate.
That's right. We walked around the estate. It's good to kind of walk once in a while.
Take in the fresh air, scenery.
That's right.
Right.
And awesome. And I've seen so much coffee out there on the estate.
All the back work that happened.
That's right.
Yeah.
So I can't wait to get into your coffee lab.
Perfect. Thank you so much for being here and welcome to our coffee lab.
Thank you.
This is parchment coffee, which is post-pulping now, and it's put out in the drying yards, which is also on our estate.
Okay.
And it's manually raked over days till it reaches a certain moisture level that we are happy with. So it's going to form a husk, a dry husk outside. And once you remove the husk, that's when you find the bean. Yeah, the green beans inside.
Okay.
So this happens at a curing facility.
In the pallet.
And the green beans are then sorted. So this whole array that we see here is Arabica.
All right, so and you've got various grades.
Yeah, various grades. So it's sorted according to size.
All right.
So the biggest size is the most expensive, most sought after coffee.
So now the color that I see is all of them are, lightish sort of
correct.
So green. So these are before roasting.
Correct, before roasting. And even in this, we sort it out saying you look for the darker green beans.
Okay.
So if it's slightly bleached, you don't use them. Again, that's called as a defect.
Oh, okay.
So to that extent, it's again sorted manually by people at the curing works. And then that's a lot of sorting.
And so these are the roasts.
These are the roast profiles.
Okay.
So we have light, medium and dark.
Okay.
And we also have different various grind sizes.
All right.
So each equipment that we use, so our focus is home brewing and home making people into home baristas.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you talk about different brewing equipments, each of them have different grind sizes that we look at.
After this nifty coffee 101, it was time to taste Classic Coffee's newest line of artisanal coffees.
So, I see there are different coffees here. With interesting labels. So you've got a Classic Blaze, you've got a Classic Matinee, Sundowner,
and an After Hours.
All right. So what's the story here?
So different coffees for different times of the day.
All right.
And I don't think that's something that's been done at least in the Indian market right now.
This is the first time that I've come across something like this.
So the whole point of this range was for new coffee drinkers.
Okay.
And now with the whole coffee drinking boom that started. The point of it is everyone wants to try, but they're a little intimidated about, what do I have? All where
right.
do I start?
Right.
So we're starting with Blaze, so that's morning.
All
and
right.
so the names itself, tells you about the different types of the different times of the day. So we have
Blaze would be
Blaze
strong.
Morning,
okay.
It's strong, it's to get you going,
right.
Start your day with. It's got flavors of nut, dark cocoa. And even when we paired it with things that you would typically have.
So I'm going to taste the Classic Blaze. This is definitely the kind of coffee that you need. That's your first. So wake me up.
Yeah, wake me up. And so you have the banana bread with that. And just the banana adds really well with the nutty sort of dark cocoa flavors that are there.
It rounds off on the palate.
Yeah.
Right? So when you just have this, it's kind of, in a good sense,
it's sharp in a good sense, yeah.
Right on your senses, and then you have this, and then you go back to it. I think it kind of mellows the impact of the coffee on the palate.
Right.
I like the fact that your packs have these. It's a very helpful kind of a pointer. Right?
Exactly. So you have your morning blend, night blend, afternoon blend written on your pack. Look at the back, it tells you what it's best had with, whether it's with milk or black.
Oh, okay.
What the best equipment you could brew it with. So that's a French press. The next one you're going to be trying is a French press.
So that's a matinee?
That's the matinee.
So I'm going to taste some of that. This is the complete opposite of the Blaze.
Correct.
On the palate.
Yeah, yeah.
To those who say coffee is coffee.
Right.
This is revelation. I like the fact that it's not very heavy on the palate.
It's not.
This is the sort of coffee that you probably sip through the afternoon and not worry about acidity at the end of the day.
Yeah, exactly. Right? That's the point of it. So, and it's also not cumbersome to make. It's a French press, one of the easiest equipments to use. So that's a dark chocolate with cherry in it. You could eat like nice fresh berries as well. Actually, one of my favorite combinations. I really like it.
Slightly tart.
Correct.
Sort of a note.
Fruity. Tart, yeah.
Wow.
So next is Sundowner.
Alright.
So as the name connotes, it's for the evening. You're done with your day, whether it's at work, at home, whatever it might be. And you're hungry, you're looking to fill your stomach up again. So a snack and a nice filter coffee.
Alright.
So these two are filter coffees, the morning blend and the evening Sundowner and Blaze.
It's definitely got more body.
Correct,
right? It does. It's kind of it gives you, it fills your mouth, right? That's what this does.
Exactly.
So do a Ruskin coffee.
Yes, do a Ruskin coffee. Try the After Hours, which is the night blend.
This is a caramel.
Yeah, so the caramel cheesecake. And you don't realize it till you have that cream with the coffee, and it really adds well, goes well with it.
You know, the coffee and the cheesecake have, in a sense, given up their individuality and have become one.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful combination.
Right.
So, is this available in stores? I mean,
we're
of course privileged to come here to your estate, walk through the plantation, look at the coffee growing and taste this with you.
Right.
But is this available?
It is.
Okay.
Slowly on shelf, it's being available because, like I said, it's just been a couple of weeks since we launched. We are available in some of the gourmet stores.
All right.
As well as online on our own websites, just Classic Coffees.
All right.
So we have our own e-commerce store and we deliver all over India.
All right.
And so nice fresh ground coffee that you need
is
at your doorstep anytime that you require.
Excellent. For those watching out there, I think this is definitely something that you should look for. I think it's coffee in a whole new avatar. Thank you very much for having us over.
Thanks, and I'm glad you.
Thank you so much for the wonderful tasting. It's truly been a revelation, and I'm going to look out for these coffees and taste some more.
We're excited.
Thank you very much. Thank you. The sun was setting over Sakleshpur, and after this very heady coffee experience, I decided to take the bike out for a spin to catch a bit more of the estate on my last day here. It was also nice to get on the bike after a full 24 hours and soak in the nippy mountain air. I set out to catch the evening skies for some quiet contemplation and, well, more coffee. It's been an amazing 2 days here at Harley Estate, experiencing the hospitality of Golden Wood. The food's been delicious, and as expected, the coffee has been great too. We've had the opportunity to meet some truly wonderful people and experience the warmth of their sincere hospitality here. But more than anything, we leave with an amazing insight, a wonderful insight into the way of life on a coffee plantation. We've savored it, and we hope you've enjoyed the ride too. Do catch the next episode of Gourmet Biker. Until then, stay safe and goodbye.